Welcome to Thinking Biologically. This episode is part two of cellular respiration and ATP, the big picture. This is the second of two videos introducing cellular respiration. If you haven't watched the first video, you might want to start with that one. As with part one, this video is connected to an interactive tutorial on sciencemusicvideos.com that you can access through a free trial subscription. In this video, we're going to focus on how most of the 30 to 32 ATPs that get made in cellular respiration get produced. This process is called oxidative phosphorylation. As I explain it, we're going to cover the following: where cellular respiration happens, the connection between oxidation, reduction, and respiration, how cells make ATP through oxidative phosphorylation, and we're going to review the highlights of the four major phases of cellular respiration. Let's go. Every cell makes its own ATP, and within eukaryotic cells, that process occurs in the cytoplasm and in the mitochondria. Here's a schematic view of these parts. Here's glucose diffusing into the cytoplasm. In the cytoplasm, the enzymes of glycolysis will render the glucose into a form that can enter the mitochondria. And as they do, a little bit of ATP is made. Oxygen is also diffusing into the cytoplasm from outside the cell. And from there, it continues into the mitochondria. Mitochondria have a double membrane, which is both a vestige of their evolutionary origins and an important structural feature in cellular respiration. Here's the outer membrane, and here's the inner membrane. Between the two is a region that's called the intermembrane space. Within the inner membrane is what's called the matrix. Essentially, this is the cytoplasm of the mitochondria. It contains multiple enzymes that are important in the Krebs cycle. Here you see ATP being secreted from the mitochondria into the cytoplasm. It's going to power the cell's work. And CO2 and water, the waste products, leaving the mitochondria and ultimately diffusing out of the cell. To understand how we get from glucose and oxygen to CO2, water, and ATP, we have to understand two chemistry-related concepts: oxidation and reduction. Oxidation means the loss of electrons. Reduction is the opposite. It's the gain of electrons. These two processes are always paired. Here's what's happening when you cook on a gas stove. The methane is being oxidized as it loses electrons and hydrogens, resulting in carbon dioxide. The oxygen is being reduced as it gains electrons and hydrogens, becoming water, and lots of heat and light are being produced. Similarly, during cellular respiration, glucose is oxidized to carbon dioxide and oxygen is reduced to water, and the energy is used to create ATP. One of the complicated things about cellular respiration is that the overall oxidation of glucose happens through several intermediate oxidations and reductions. So it's not like this, a single-step rapid oxidation, but it's many small steps, like this one representing the electron transport chain. The negative delta G's that you see on the stairway represent the fact that each intermediate oxidation and reduction gives off energy that can power work. And that work is to set up the conditions for making ATP through oxidative phosphorylation. These two molecules, NADH and FADH2, are called mobile electron carriers. Both, like ATP, are classified as nucleotides, but instead of trading off phosphate groups, they trade electrons and hydrogens. Let's look at NADH first. It's the reduced form. It can be oxidized to its counterpart, NAD+, and that supplies energy to drive the electron transport chain. And using energy from food, NAD+, the low-energy oxidized form, can be chemically reduced back to NADH, which is the high-energy form. Pretty much the same thing happens with FADH2. In three places in cellular respiration, enzymes take electrons from food and use them to reduce these mobile electron carriers. It happens here in glycolysis, here in the link reaction, and here in the Krebs cycle. Now look at these dotted lines. They're showing NADH and FADH2 feeding into the electron transport chain. The chain is a series of enzymes embedded in the inner mitochondrial membrane, organized in a linear array. There are thousands of these arrays along the inner mitochondrial membrane. That's partly why that inner membrane is so intensely folded. Now, let's shift to a much more detailed depiction. Here's the matrix. You can see the reduced electron carriers, NADH and FADH2, dropping off their electrons. These electrons flow along the electron transport chain, represented by the yellow arrow, which is built into the mitochondrial inner membrane. This electron energy is essentially an electrical current. We use electricity to light lights and to power computers, motors, radios, etc. The mitochondria use this electricity to power proton pumps. These pump protons from the matrix to the intermembrane space. The intermembrane space is a closed compartment. Protons can't get through the phospholipid bilayers of either the inner or outer mitochondrial membrane. The protons packed into that space are like the water trapped behind a dam. They're a form of potential energy. Engineers build dams and then use turbines to convert the potential energy of the trapped water into electricity. Mitochondria do something that's analogous, but on a nanoscale. In the mitochondrial inner membrane, there's a transmembrane channel that's called ATP synthase. It's a channel for protons, and it's an enzyme. When protons diffuse from the intermembrane space back to the matrix, ATP synthase uses the kinetic energy of these diffusing protons to convert ADP and P into ATP. This process is called oxidative phosphorylation because the electron transport chain can only run if oxygen is present. You see this here, where oxygen is shown as the last electron acceptor in the chain. If oxygen isn't present, electrons don't flow. If electrons don't flow, protons don't get pumped. If protons don't get pumped, ATP synthase can't make ATP from ADP and phosphate. This process is also called chemiosmosis. That's because the diffusion of protons through the ATP synthase channel reminded Peter Mitchell, the Nobel laureate who discovered this process in the 1960s, of osmosis, the diffusion of water. The chorus of my electron transport chain song tells you almost everything you need to know about this process. Here it is.
The mitochondrial electron transport chain uses electron energy for pumping protons from the mitochondrial matrix to the intermembrane space, increasing proton concentration in that place. The only way the protons can escape is through a channel and an enzyme ATP synthase, which uses diffused protons' kinetic energy to make ATP from ADP and P.
So now, let's walk through this diagram with all of our accumulated knowledge. The process starts with glucose diffusing into cells. If there's no glucose or other food source or stored energy from your body's own energy stores, then the cycle won't run. Glycolysis takes glucose and oxidizes it, creating two NADHs. Substrate-level phosphorylations create two ATPs. The end result is two 3-carbon molecules called pyruvate, also known as pyruvic acid. Note that after glycolysis, the next two phases of cellular respiration run twice, once for each molecule of pyruvate. The second step is the link reaction. Pyruvate is brought into the mitochondria. Enzymes oxidize the pyruvate and remove a carbon dioxide, creating a 2-carbon molecule that's called acetyl-CoA. Note that the oxidation of pyruvate is accompanied by the reduction of NAD+ to NADH. Now the third step. Acetyl-CoA enters the Krebs cycle. The enzymes in the Krebs cycle use acetyl-CoA's chemical energy to power a substrate-level phosphorylation of ADP to ATP and a reduction of NAD+ and FAD to NADH and FADH2. For each acetyl-CoA that enters the cycle, 2 carbon dioxides are released as waste products. Finally, in the fourth step, all of these reduced NADHs and FADH2s are used to power the electron transport chain, which powers the proton pumping that sets up ATP synthase to convert ADP and phosphate into ATP. To get your head around all of this, go to the tutorial that I've written at sciencemusicvideos.com. All of the quizzes will solidify your learning, and that is just a foundation for the next step. In an AP or college level biology course, you're going to need to know the details of this process, not just an overview. I want you to use my songs, my tutorials about glycolysis, the Krebs cycle, and the electron transport chain to master all of that. So please do a couple of things. Subscribe to my channel, Science Music Videos. Like this video, share this video, leave me comments and questions. Above all, sign up for a free trial of sciencemusicvideos.com. The tutorials are going to help you so much. You won't believe how much you're going to learn. Thank you so much.
Welcome to the story about cell energy. The goal is explaining